Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Dr. Mama K. Kemi Akiode Adebayo, but known as Dr. Mama K. And I'm the CEO for Bold Moves. And we are having our August edition of The Future is Female Virtual Roundtable. Welcome. Thank you, everybody that's joining on from Ghana, from South Africa, Wales. I'm still trying to see Wales. Yeah, Nigeria, of course. Molweni, how are we all doing? Saubana, bonjour, bonsoir, sonu, ekale, I will go on, you know, where we're joining us from. Thank you all. Remember, just a bit of housekeeping. Please mute yourself, although we would mute you as best as we can. And this is a collaboration, an original event by the Leading Women of Africa, which Bold Moves is collaborating and supporting with. And yes, it is going to be an amazing session. So without much further ado, I want to welcome our dear president for the Leading Women of Africa, just to do an opening remark, and then we'll take it from there. Miss Madeline Nkuna, over to you.
Great. Thank you again, Mama Kay. Thank you for this important, very important session of The Future is Female. So, excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we have some gentlemen in the house, all protocol observed. I would like to welcome you to this session of The Future is Female, of the 18th of August, 2023. I sincerely want to believe that you will agree that definitely the global future is definitely female. So my sincere thank to Ma'am Gwen Mahlangu and Mrs. Dudley, who have served our country for many years at the highest level and contributed to shape the future of this country. And not only on the country level, even at the personal level, I am proud to say these two women have supported the vision of RWA for many, many years. So, Ma'am Mahlangu, Mrs. Dudley, thank you again for accepting our invitation to come basically talk to us on the issue of the women's political leadership in Africa, the challenges and the solutions. I think by the end of this meeting, what we want to come out with is how do we improve our representation at a political level? We believe that we will all be inspired. And I would like to just appeal to every woman, every man in this house, is that we need to reflect as we'll be going through this discussion, this engagement and exchange of solutions and not only problems, but solutions as well. You know, let's reflect on how we will, and I'm using the word we, so that because it's all, this Africa is for all of us, how we will meaningfully contribute to the socioeconomic development of our beloved continent. We salute and remember the courageous women that who have gone before us across Africa. We have so many courageous women that have walked the walk and have really paved the way for us. And today we are commemorating or remembering the courageous women who have gone before us. You know, for the case of South Africa, a group of courageous women took the risk to walk to Union Building in 1956 to claim the rights of women so that we all sitting in this room could benefit from that. And August being South African Women's Month, hence we thought we actually want to remember them. We want to remember where we come from. We are beneficiaries of some people that have paid the price, some people that have been courageous to walk and say, we want women's right to be acknowledged. We want women's voice to be acknowledged. And there are so many across the continent before that have walked the walk before us. However, if we look back, despite this freedom that women are entitled to in South Africa or across the continent, it has been, I mean, the African continent started having their independence already 60 years ago. And we are really sad to notice that the progress of women continue to lag behind, even 60 years after, you know. And I think the call is to all of us in this room to be active, to be participant, and try to find a solution to what do we think the problem could be. How can we improve the representation of women in political spheres? Because we want more women. We want more women at decision-making spheres so that they can influence basically how the society is being run, so they can have a word, a voice into the process of development of our continent. So finally, let me just mention this before I give over back to Mama Kay. We will urge you not to leave after the panel discussion, because after politics, there will be business. So there's always a B2B session straight after the panel discussion. And not only that, there's also an after party that is always led by Mama Kay, who really is good in just making people to not only entertain, but also just to reflect back, but through entertainment. So Mama Kay, over to you. And I would like to thank everyone in the room. And it's such an honor to have you amongst us. Thank you so much. Over to you, Mama Kay.
Thank you, my dear sister, Miss Madeleine Nkunu, the President for Leading Women of Africa, which this event is really their baby project supported by Bold Moves Africa, working in collaboration. You heard her there. We are talking about women's political leadership in Africa, the challenges and the solutions. So we want to focus more on solutions, because yes, I think by now we all know most of the challenges. And like Miss Madeleine, you know, pointed out there, we've had over 20,000 women for us in South Africa who said enough was enough. And that's why we're doing this for the month of August. And we are so blessed to have two amazing politicians who have worked their way up in South African politics in different form. And, you know, who said enough too was enough, and they wanted to make sure women's voices are heard. So let me first introduce Miss Cheryllyn Dudley. She is a former Member of Parliament in South Africa. She is an author of Through My Eyes, Life, Politics, and Religion, and she is based in South Africa. And my dear sister, I call her Sis Gwen, and she is Gwen Mahlangu-Nkabinde. She is a former Speaker of South African Parliament, and she is based in South Africa. Just a brief introduction there. My dear two panelists, how are we doing? Let's just hear your voice. Miss Dudley, if you could go first. Miss Dudley?
I'm unmuted. Okay. That was good. Hi, everybody. It's so lovely to be with you, and it's a great honor. Thank you.
And my guest is Gwen.
Good afternoon, my sisters and brothers. And I'm very excited to be part of this topic as I walked the path. So most of the things that I will be talking about are things that I have lived, things that I've experienced. And thank you very much, Leading Women of Africa, for choosing such an appropriate topic. I mean, when I was struggling with my flu, I said, I mean, I even missed my birthday on the 16th. I was in bed. But I said, on the 18th, I must really get up. And I'm very happy for the doctors and everyone who was looking after me. I'm looking forward to a very, very exciting afternoon. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, panelists, for that.
Can I just say a quick hi to my sister, Gwen? It's so lovely to be able to share the platform with you. I'm honored.
Hello, Cheryllyn. We shared the platform, I think, about 10 years ago in Cape Town when we started doing this work with Madeleine. And I'm happy because earlier on I heard that you may not be able to make it and I was feeling a little sad.
But I'm shame
to see also, to see.
But she is here.
Yeah, and I'm also happy to see some friends that I haven't seen for a long time. But Habile Zamini, Gwen Lithuania, and Tiny Mahano. Tiny will come from the same area in Karangua, actually. So it's just an honor to see LWA growing the way it is. Yeah, okay.
All right. Thank you very much, dear amazing panelists. And we can't wait to hear more from you. And welcome again to all those who've just joined. Remember to mute yourself, please, so that we can hear each other well. And remember to use the chat room. If you have questions, please use the chat room. And I can see a lot of people already saying, you know, a lot of things in there. But we will come to the chat room very, very soon. Welcome to everyone, you know, joining us from Botswana, Ghana, South Africa, Nigeria. If I've missed the country just now, do forgive me. You are most welcome. So let me start first with our dear sister, you know, Miss Cheryllyn Dudley. Let me tell you a little bit more about her. She is a South African politician who served as a member of the National Assembly of South Africa under the African Christian Democratic Party. She served from 1999 till when she, you know, retired from the parliament. And she, Miss Dudley, attended high school in Zimbabwe, and she later studied at the University of Natal, where she obtained a Bachelor of Laws. And she has served in various capacity as Parliament Whip and so on and so forth. But we will hear more about that when we want to talk to her under different portfolio, you know, as well. And so, Miss Dudley, let me start with my first question to you.
Sure.
What do you think for you personally has been some of the key challenges as a female political leader in South Africa?
Well, in my experience, the biggest challenge faced by women in the political sphere is gaining the respect and the trust of both men and women. So those we work with and those we represent, and of course, those whose votes will either give us a platform and a voice or not. So people in general have been programmed over the ages to automatically trust men in most positions of authority, as they've had the opportunities to master their craft in these areas. And some have squandered the opportunities, of course, but others have excelled. So we now have opportunities to be seen and heard in positions of authority, and we too can squander them or excel. When we have been victims of circumstance, it is natural to be defensive. We take things personally or as a group identity more than that is technically necessary. And this does not help instill confidence. So we are we're there to make wise, rational input and decisions on behalf of those that we represent. So this will require us to listen, to learn, and to communicate effectively.
Right. Thank you for that. Obviously, there you've shared some of the challenges and even what we could do in terms of solution, listening and learning, you know, effectively. Let me now introduce my dear sister. And then, you know, the way we're going to do this, some questions, we'll be going back and forth. The good thing for us is there's only two of you as panelists, so we will be able to go into some of the questions and to engage with our audience as best as we can, you know, as well, because we want the audience, you know, our guests to feel, you know, to be comfortable to ask questions as best as they can. So let me tell you a little bit more about Sis Gwen. She was born Gwendolyn Lindiwe, known as Gwen Mahlangu-Nkabinde. She was born on the 16th of August. Like she said, her birthday was just recently, even though she couldn't celebrate it because of the flu. And she is a South African politician who was the former Speaker of the South African Parliament. She was the Speaker from 2008 to 2009, and she became Deputy Speaker in 2004, and, you know, she rose up the rank there. She was later appointed as the Minister of Public Works in 2010, even though she had served as the Deputy Minister of Economic Development as well from 2009 to 2020. She was in various committees as a politician, from various, being chairperson of Portfolio Committee on Environmental Affairs, president of Globe Southern Africa, co-president of Stakeholder Forum. I could go on and on and on about our amazing Sis Gwen. So Sis Gwen, I know there are probably some things I've even missed there, but tell us a little bit about yourself and what you feel as well, like Mrs. Dudley has said about, for you personally, what has been some of the challenges as a female politician?
Well, it has been a feeling of pride to be given an opportunity to serve your country. But it came at a price, because women today may be ready to take office. When we started in 1994, we did not know what to expect. We did not know that being a political leader and being in government are two different things. There are things that are expected from you as a person running the state or running a province, as compared to being active in a political party. Now, we were not prepared for those kind of things. And we were getting into an arena that was designated for men. So almost everything that we were doing, especially our first group, was to change things and say things have to be done differently because we are there. And fortunately for us and Cheryl and other members of parliament that I have invited, I've seen one, we had a female speaker when we started in 1994. So going to her and asking for certain things to be changed was very, very easy. And South Africa was having a female speaker for the first time. And as much as all of you would have remembered her, is that she never took nonsense and she never allowed anyone to take advantage of women. So we came into that environment, which was male-dominated, which had people with research capacities, which we did not have. We did not have financial expertise and resources that are needed for a member of parliament. It is not only your salary that you need. There are a number of things that you have to do, and for that you need finances. We did not have that. We had lack of planning. I mean, we could not plan anything because a lot of us did not have the necessary skills to make you exceptional in your work. And as a result, the confidence women had started dwindling. You know, they would always ask for less time to participate in committee, less time to do certain things. But fortunately, as we start this discussion, we as women stood up and said, we need to change the status quo. We need to make sure that we need to get those skills that are necessary for us to be meaningful members of parliament, for not only ourselves, but even the communities that we represent. When we go back home, we should be going back with stories that show them that they did not make a mistake by choosing us. I can go on and on, but I know this is interactive. I need to allow other people to participate also, but as soon as you say, I want to stand for public office, you need to know that it is not going to be easy. Yes, when people see you dressed beautifully like you, Mama Kay, people think, oh man, it's a rosy thing. I also want to be there. It's very tough. But once we have understood how tough it is and what you need as resources to get out of it, it becomes a very lovely thing. I had my journey. My journey started as a whip of parliament. I usually brag when I speak to my grandchildren that, you know, I've occupied all positions of parliament. Then I became the chairperson of the environment committee, where today when I look at environmental laws that were passed during my time, I feel very proud. Because I usually say, if you look at that act, it will say, I, Gwen Mahlangu, I'm presenting this to the president. It's a feeling of gratitude that at times you are given an opportunity by your political parties. Then I walked to be deputy speaker, and I also deputized a very tough woman, and I learned a lot. Two of my predecessors were very strong women, so I learned a lot from them. And when I became speaker, I was just sailing through nicely because I had all the skills and everything that I needed to know. But like I'm saying, I'll keep on coming in with information that I'm leaving behind at the moment. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Sis Gwen. And let me go back to you, Mrs. Dudley, there. Like Sis Gwen said, in terms of our journey. Now, let me go a little bit back. Did you ever know you wanted to become a politician? Was it something that you were like, okay, you know, as a career, oh yes, you know, what do you want to do? I want to become a politician. Did you know that? You need to unmute yourself, ma'am.
Am I done?
Now we can move.
Not really. I would say I was a natural entrepreneur. I would always see what seemed to be necessary or what had given me some fulfillment in my life and try to make that available to other people. So that was my natural urge. But of course, here in Africa, things were sort of politically charged. And I think once I became aware that I was so not aware of the realities, that I was just sort of conscious of wanting an awareness of what was going on. And I went overseas very young. So I was sort of 17, 18.
Sorry, unmute yourself. Sorry, I think they muted you by mistake. Can you unmute yourself? There's somebody they were trying to unmute. Miss Dudley, please unmute yourself. Hello, Miss Dudley. We need you to unmute. Yeah, I think we had an error. The technical people were trying to mute somebody and they muted you in the error. Okay. Sorry about that.
So I'll say, I didn't really ever think specifically of being involved in politics. I was a natural entrepreneur, sort of looking for where the needs were and then trying to help supply people with opportunities to become what they needed to become, etc. But at the same time, I did travel from very young. So at 17, 18, I was overseas, and looking back on Africa from that vantage point, I couldn't believe what I hadn't seen. and obviously that awareness grew. And, you know, once you've kind of got a broader perspective, you look back, well, let's put it this way, your words then start to line up with that broader perspective, you start asking questions, you start making people uncomfortable, and so I think just in a natural sense, politics, it happens at every level of life, and we were destined on the side of the world to pioneer things that other people hadn't yet got right.
Okay, so that's an interesting one. You've been an entrepreneur and then going into politics, because sometimes people think you cannot combine, and even an author, you've written a book, you know, and I'm hoping to see more of your books as well written. So how do you think, as women leaders, how can we improve impact in the African continent as women leaders?
Well, you know, Just speaking, following on from what Gwen was saying about the incredible example we had from our two very strong female speakers who had to learn on the in the moment themselves. It wasn't as if they had great role models to turn to, but we were very fortunate in that. And one of the things that stood out for me was that, you've heard, we've often heard that slogan, fake it till you make it. But they, for me, modeled a different approach, and that would be face it till we ace it. So facing whatever our purpose in life is and our challenges along the way, as with everything else in life, it requires one step at a time. And sometimes just getting off the couch is a meaningful step, studying relevant courses, learning to listen, practicing listening long enough to hear what other people, the other person is saying, and not what we think that they're saying, is very important. And to ask the right questions, and a lot of being in the position of a member of parliament is to listen long enough to know what questions need to be asked to uncover what we need to understand, because we don't always know what we need to understand before we can have any relevant input. We're very quick off the mark to want to shoot off solutions when we haven't really got to that place. So learning to speak to people and not at them and past them. Another very important thing that was stood out for me, and getting involved then, of course, in relevant NGOs or political party election campaign with a view to learning. This would be things people would start to do when they're thinking about politics, or applying for a job where you can learn how things operate from the bottom up. Never being afraid to actually start at ground level. It's a great disadvantage to start above ground level, because you're going to have to learn all those lessons, and you've got to learn them in the face of everybody watching you make your mistakes, which is what we had to do as the world stopped and we got into politics in those early days. So we've had everybody forefront. So, however, we're at this point now, and it's important to read broadly, both current and historical global politics, and learning about the successes and failures of others who had a similar purpose or mission to ourselves. Not just to read or listen to people that we agree with, we've got to listen to the rational arguments against these positions that we hold as well. We have to test our assumptions. We have to test the theories that we have about life and things, and that takes courage. And that whole thing about instead of faking it until we make it, we face it until we ace it, is about being authentic. Not to do the job, and this is where I think of our speakers. They didn't do the job as some man might have done it, or somebody else would do it. They simply did it as themselves, and they were determined to make that enough, that they pitched up to do the job. They did it with sincerity and integrity, and it was enough, and it was inspirational.
Right. Thank you for that. I love that, and I think a lot of people are now agreeing with that slogan, face it until you ace it. I can already see Abigail agreeing with you in the chat room. That's the first I've heard of that, and I'm hoping as well to use it. And thanks for sharing that journey, along the way, from being, an entrepreneur, and then, traveling the world, and then going into politics. And now, we'll probably want to find out what you're now up to nowadays. But let me now bring Sis Gwen in. Sis Gwen, I know we'll probably need a whole full program to hear your journey, from a young child, into now going through different, department or committees within the parliament and so on in politics. Tell us a little bit about your journey. How did you always know you wanted to become a politician? And, how has the journey been for you personally, Sis Gwen?
Yes, the answer is I've never thought I would end up being a politician. Never. I was at university in 1976. And as you know what happened in 1976, my studies had to come to an end. And unfortunately, I was on a bursary, which then said, if you terminate your studies, which I did not terminate, I was terminated. So they can no longer go along with me. I went back home. Fortunately, when I was at university, I had to choose law. I loved law all the time. But when I went back home, I found my teachers, who were my teachers in matric. And they said to me, Gwen, we have a shortage of mathematics teachers. Can you come and help? Because you are one of our best students. And then I said to my mom, who was also a teacher, this is something that's going to keep me busy and make me forget about all the problems that I've had. So I started doing that. And after doing that, I'm sorry.
The video, I know.
the people want to see my face.
We want to see your face. I didn't want to interrupt there. We want to see your face if you can.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'm fixing that.
Okay.
I'm fixing that.
I know technology sometimes is so tough.
No, I'm there now.
We can see you now.
So I did that alongside community work. I was very, very fortunate that when I did community work, I worked with people like knowing about the lives of people like Mayor Frances Bart, because she did not live very far from me. So she was also an influence on her journey. Her journey wrapped off so nicely on me. And one of the guests that you have today, Tiny Mahano, her father actually sharpened my early days in politics, Ntate Peter Mahano. May his soul rest in peace. Because he served on Robben Island for quite some time during the time with Nelson Mandela. And I'm very happy to see his daughter today interested in politics, because I've always said, Tiny, you have everything that it takes to be in politics. So then I was noticed by, you know, some people in the church for leadership positions and so on. And when the UDF became very active, some people saw me and they wanted to recommend me for what, you know, starting from street committee to anything, until we started becoming very active in the 80s preparing. But honestly speaking, it's something that I landed on. Thanks to the apartheid regime, I would not have been a politician, because I wanted just to be a lawyer, get money and be rich and forget about anything, everything else. But they diverted me, and in that diversion, I found my passion, which is politics. And I still love the politics even up to today. And if I have an opportunity of going back, I will take Cheryl Luke and go back running to our positions there. But also to say, what we also understood, a lot of people talk about Parliament today as a rough area and so on. We also knew that we differ on certain things. I differed many times with Cheryl. She's one of my best sisters, but we differed on principled issues that she believed in strongly and so on. But one thing that we used to do, as we travel as committees to other countries, maybe to go and do one or two things, we would always look at the bigger picture, which is the country, and not our political parties. I remember one time when we were in Cuba, the ambassador there said, are you all from the same party? And I said, no, we are not. I was leading a small delegation of about 8 people. I said, no, we have everybody here. At that time, there was no Democratic Alliance, but there was a Democratic Party and so on. So I said, no, we come from all different walks of life, but we are here to represent South Africa and get the best for South Africa back to the country. So we learned that the bigger picture is the country and not us and not our political parties. And for me, I wish that is something that we can take back to newer, younger MPs and show them that You may differ on certain things, but look at what we want from you. We want the country to be the best.
Thank you, ma'am, you know, for that. And I think that is a very, very important, you know, point you made, you know, the fact that, yes, you are all from, you know, different parties, but at the end of the day, you look at the bigger picture. So it goes beyond your party, even though you differ, you know, in terms of principle and what you agree on. But when you're looking at the bigger picture, how can we make sure this is about South Africa, if you're politicians, or about Kenya, if you're politicians there? Let me now go, I'm just trying to see now, we're doing things a little bit slightly different this time for those who've been joining us. We don't want you to get used to the same thing all the time. So I will go on into the chat room just to see if there's any questions at this stage. And I think a lot of people are agreeing with what is being said, so that we don't forget somehow, or if you want to contribute, you might not necessarily have a question, but if you want to contribute as well, just put up your hand so we see you, and we'll maybe take one or two, or just write, you know, in the chat room, your contribution. I know there's been a few people, you know, agreeing, like I said, with what most people have said. I hope the person who had the audio problem is sorted. Joyce Bandit, you're welcome from Malawi. As always, you always come to support us. We can't wait. And, oh, okay, Dr. Oji has a friend, a religious leader with Witness Chapel, who has joined her and part of the session. It's good to see people from different faith, like you heard Sis Gwen said. She too started in church. So now, while I'm waiting for questions to come, let me now go back to Mrs. Dudley here. How can one, if I'm saying, and I'm going to ask the same question to Sis Gwen, how can I, you know, a young girl, maybe in Guguletu in Cape Town here, of 7-year-old, maybe Sipo, my name is Sipo, I'm 7 years old, and I think, you know what, I want to become a politician because I've seen a local councillor doing good things. How can one get into politics? If you need to unmute yourself, Mrs. Dudley. We need you to unmute yourself. Sorry, ma'am.
Hey.
Okay. Right. Now we
thank you. Thank you. Well, I think the desire to be in politics is probably not the healthiest thing to do. I think the desire to do is to actually want to help the country to become what the country needs to become, individuals to become what they need to become. And I think if we get involved with the realities of those things, the other comes. And it never hurts to study something like law or African policy, and, you know, whatever kind of gives us a broader picture. But it's a big rounded picture. And it's also, I think, where the testing comes is that we're prepared to not just immediately follow what we think is our passion, because we can't possibly know that when we haven't lived. So the thing to do would be to follow whatever you need to be doing at that particular time that has to become your passion. You know, so it could be that you're going to travel because you've got such a small perspective and you want to see more of the world, and then you're going to work and do these things, and you've got to do what you have to do. And sometimes that's peeling potatoes. I had to peel potatoes, and you have to, you go to places where you don't speak the language and people treat you like an idiot. And, you know, this is all part of becoming that person that we have to become. So to focus on being a politician is really counterproductive. But focus on becoming who we need to become, and then seeing what it is that we can bring to the table in terms of being courageous, being authentic, and also just having humility and the humility.
Yes, very much. They're giving you money. Thank you so much. I'll come back again. Okay, and then I'll give you some more.
Sorry about that. We need
sorry,
to
do
unmute.
I unmute again?
No, you're good. We're just
am I still fine?
Yeah,
yes.
The person, please. Thank you.
So it's then that having enough humility to know that we don't know everything and we can be wrong. Because there's nothing worse than actually dealing with people who think they're never wrong. and actually, none of us have the entire picture. We need each other in that situation. So I would say, let go of hard and fast ideas of what we think we want to be and focus on being the best that we can be. And a lot of times that means doing everything we can within the circumstances that we're in and making the best of that. And finding the opportunities from there. So that would be my advice there. But can I pop back to what my sister was saying earlier, just in terms of people agendas and people with party agendas and how you have to put those things aside to actually honestly go forward. And I think many people, especially in politics, they feel braver behind an agenda or story framed for them by somebody else. So they, especially in politics, feel braver hiding behind an agenda, like policy, party propaganda, conspiracy theories, media bias. So even when we're very young, we kind of want to cotton onto something that kind of forms our identity, which is crazy because we don't at that stage know anything. We know very little. We need to become part of life, become part of this big picture before we start labeling ourselves as something or having some tape recording in our brain that causes us to be saying a certain thing that we always want to protect rather than explore.
Right. Thank you very much for that, Mrs. Dudley. Says Gwen, so yes, same question, but this time I want to add the element of when, basically, why are we not getting people wanting to be politicians? Why do people run away from politics?
That's good. I just wondered if I was okay.
I think it's not easy for people to want to be in politics. And I think Cheryl is very right that people are driven by circumstances to take politics. We are not fortunate like other people who want politics to be a career. They go to school knowing very well that I want to end up in the Senate, I want to end up somewhere. We are driven by circumstances around us. When there's poverty around you and when you can see women are being abused and something like that, if you have leadership in you, it actually speaks to you to say, do something about it. So most of us, and that is the answer I would give the girl in Google to, that who is your role model? What do you want to achieve? And so on and so forth. That is why even at Matric, when you speak to them, even at university, there are very few of them who want to take up seats in politics. And it is because we have not made it attractive. We should also make it attractive. And I'll give a little story, and I'm happy that there are women from Ghana here whom I think should meet my granddaughter. She was preparing a political speech yesterday. I don't know whether Ghana is going to be having elections very soon, but she was representing a different party and telling people why they should be, you know, it is an exercise that they had to do for her class work. And I said to her, Chipo, where did you learn all this? Says, no, my teacher gave me notes and I had to study the notes and so on and so forth. But if you inculcate that spirit in a child that young, that please play a role and understand what is happening. You know, she was speaking, she's about 11, she was speaking about democracy in a way that a number of adults won't even understand what it means and so on. So, that's why I'm saying the women in Ghana, they should know that there's a big politician in South Africa who is enjoying that. She's just young. But we need to make politics very attractive to the younger generation by not at all times. Yes, things did not go very well, maybe at some stage for us. But let us not stay on the negative side only. Let us also show them the positives. I mean, I always say to them, I managed to lead the Africa group of women at the IPU because women from other countries saw something in me and they wanted me to participate. Maybe at some stage we will actually get into those groups that represent women so that we make sure that they are strong and they carry the voice of women at all times. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Sis Gwen, for that. And I really can't wait, you know, to hear more about your grandchild. And I think we please, can I remind people to please mute themselves? Please, thank you. It's very distracting and it is rude, if I may say so. Please mute yourself and technical. Please mute people as quickly as you can. So yes, you know, somebody, Gladys has said, yes, Ghana will be voting next year. And like Mundy said here, we run away because, like Ms. Cheryl said, you're given a policy to accept an identity to take on. And if you have a different view, then you're not given the chance to explore and be different. I'm trying to see. There is a question here somewhere. Let me just try and see. Lydia is saying, thank you so much for this discussion. It is really great. Many of the people in leadership in South Africa, especially those in the ruling party, started as leaders in churches and were groomed by religion to lead passionately. Now, why has it happened that religion has now been looked at as the enemy of great leadership and is being kicked out of government in South Africa? Why don't we find ways to correct the religious wrongs instead of removing it? I am Dr. Lydia Monk, a pastor, philanthropist, a writer of 55 books, including leadership books, and African ambassador of Global Institute, working with Africans in the diaspora to bring development to Africa. Wow. Sis Gwen, that's powerful. What's said there about religion and politics. I don't know whether you want to go first to just respond, you know, to that. Sis Gwen or Mrs. Dudley?
I think Ms. Dudley would be better equipped to.
Okay. Mrs. Dudley? Can we start you? We need you to unmute, ma'am.
Unmute, okay. Thank you. This links back to what Gwen was saying as well, because if we look at politics as a career, it's just a career and a way of making some kind of money or life or whatever, we miss out on actually fulfilling our purpose in life. So a meaningful purpose or calling always aims to serve. So politics, we shouldn't be looking at it as some kind of career or to get a job, because you can lose that job at any second. You stick your neck up high enough for 5 minutes, your party will chop it off, or someone else will chop it off. So it is a very unstable place to aim. But when you aim at serving, then it's often a thankless task, serving. But it is what makes life worth living. So that's fulfilling your purpose, and that links now to the question that the doctor had actually asked now in terms of religion and whatever, because serving with enthusiasm in the true sense of the word means to be full of God. So serving with enthusiasm, and that's very helpful, because you can't really take all the difficulties of it being such a thankless task. If you're not enthusiastic in a way that you're actually full of God, you're actually wanting to do these things for people, regardless of whether they're seeing it for what it is or for what it isn't, because you can be things can be taken so wrong. Our job, of course, is generally in life, but also as politicians, to not panic or become defensive. We can own our mistakes, and we can apologize, we can laugh, we can even cry if we must, but preferably in the toilet or car on the way home, because once women cry, we get labeled. So smile or just swallow hard in the face of people's derogatory, spiteful or unfair comments. And this is something, you see, it takes courage to stand and be able to publicly make mistakes. Because of course, you need to be humble enough to be able to be putting it out there. So as a human being, we will make mistakes. So we swallow hard in the face of unfair comments. We try to see why that other person may have got the wrong impression. And then we just get on with the job of choosing to believe that those who need to will see us for who we are eventually. Besides, what people say about us says more about them than about us. And it's just as true that what we say to and about other people says more about us than about them. So that's where we have to be authentic, courageous, and humble enough to know that we're not always right and that we need to listen. So we're lifting ourselves up by lifting up other people. So that would be the goal. And of course, talking about why do we think religion has to be something separate? Well, it can't be, because we've got to do this with enthusiasm, being full of God. That's what gives us the drive. Otherwise, it just becomes selfish ambition. So this, of course, we practice in the nursery. Later, we take it into our community and then into our office, and we practice it with those that deserve it in our estimation and those that don't, those who cannot reciprocate our efforts as well as those who can. Our constituents and colleagues may or might not choose to hear what we say, but they do see what we do consistently. So what we do when we think no one is looking, of course, also says more about us than what we do in front of other people. So getting that sense of just being who we are and knowing it's enough. If God wants us to be there, we're going to be full of his enthusiasm and passion, and it's his business to get the job done as long as we pitch up and we don't panic.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Dudley there. Let me take a few more comments from the chat room. Commendable work from women, and I realize that for women, women have had to work more than men since leadership was patriarchal. It took zeal, willpower, and tenacity for women to be recognized. Somebody says, Gladys, women run away from politics because we are always very sincere. And the male politicians do not. Where is it now? Sorry, I just zoomed past it. Do not like that. And I'm one of the ones as well that I've always run away from politics, even though somehow I got into politics in Scotland, by the way, but I'm still running away from it. And I'm going to ask a question about this question by, or comment by Dr. Kalu Idioma, ties in with the question I want to ask the panelists. Basically, Dr. Kalu is saying, it's high time we develop working template for African women taking leadership in politics at topmost. Somebody mute Pauline, please. Thank you. A lot have been said, but I believe coming together with workable template for all African women in quest for political leadership. So taking that as a start, panelists, and I'll start with you, Sis Gwen. How can women leaders forge meaningful partnership in order to advance the women's development agenda?
I also wanted to comment on the earlier comment, and by saying that the party that I come from was formed mainly by people who are religious leaders. So I am not opposed, and I did say earlier on that my leadership was actually groomed from the churches itself. So I do respect the churches as much as At times I do have differences here and there. Like I was saying, we do have differences with Dudley, but when we look at the bigger picture is bigger than the two of us put together, or even 400 of us put together. So coming to the point that you have just raised now, I feel that there are a number of things that we need to do. One is that we need to be consistent. And by being consistent is, and I'll make a major Banda one of the examples. We were crying all the time as women, we want female presidents. We got female presidents and we never supported them. So that is the biggest problem that we have, that we will usher in women into positions, but once they are there, we leave them on their own. And obviously the system that is against women leadership will make sure that they don't succeed. A number of examples that I can make. One of the organizations that Parliaments of Africa belong to is the Africa Group of the Inter-Parliamentary Union. What happens there? We were fortunate because, like I'm saying, we had very strong speakers. We had strong deputy speakers who would make sure that, I'll make sure that Mama Kay goes to conference this year, goes to conference next year, and has just been, you know, elected to something, it continues. So you would find that some of the women in the countries, just because they go back home and they become vocal, they are scrapped for attending more conferences. So every time you speak to different people, you can't continue with what you started last year, because suddenly now there are new people that you have to start off with and say, can we please start doing this together? I will be happy with something that helps women, and it's something that it's uniform all over to say, this is what needs to be done. But I also believe that our November meeting will help us to have a pool, so that as soon as my name is called as Cheryllyn Dudley, you are ready to be a member of parliament. Before you can even sit on a desk in parliament, you need to be trained, which we do not do. You need to be trained thoroughly. You need to understand what it is about. You know, some of us who went in early, we did not even have a choice. You could not choose that I want to be in the education portfolio committee or agriculture. You were put there by your chief whips. I remember I had to work on environmental affairs. I come from poverty, where the environment is destroyed, and started must defend the environment. I must make sure that I am behind the rules and laws that are protecting this environment. What did I have to do? I had to study, because I had no skills. I was chairperson of the environment committee, but I took advantage of the fact that Gwen, you are in Cape Town. There's UCT, there are universities, there are technicons around. Just go to their environmental departments and tell them that you need to be skilled so that you understand what happens. And Sharon can tell you that the environment committee, that was not interesting because people did not like to listen to insects and birds and everything. We had to put in life there, and it became lively because we had to go and get skills from people who are skilled. You have no time as a member of parliament. You have no time to go and study and implement tomorrow. It's on the job thing that you have to do, because people are expecting you to pass laws. People are not expecting you, much as they know that when they elected you, you didn't have certain skills, but suddenly people expect you to be able to give them those skills. So it's a very nice journey that as we talk with the honorable member, we will show some of these things that happened. We had to go back and be students to be able to make meaningful contributions in South Africa and in the world, especially because what I wanted to say also was that people in the US, the UK, your Scotland, as you mentioned, are actually groomed from an early age that this is what you want to do and this is how you're going to do it. They are not driven by poverty like us, poverty and need and deprivation. No, they know very well that I'm going to study. That is why when you listen to their debates are a little different from ours, because they've got researchers, they've got everything. But I'm very happy now that we are doing that in our country. And I'm hoping that other African countries are also doing the same. But I'm calling for our sisters who are MPs to make sure that they support each other. Once we can support each other, we're a formidable group. Men know it. They know it very well that when you bring three women together, it's like you're bringing 40 men together. And my brothers should please pardon me for saying that. But we've got this power because we are responsible for life. And once we're responsible for life, there is nothing else that you cannot be responsible for. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sis Gwen, for that powerful, you know, contribution. And a lot of people are agreeing with you that you're on point. You know, how do we get women to support each other? We cry for these things and then we don't. Mrs. Dudley, can you please, let's hear your views. If you could unmute yourself, ma'am.
Got it. it is our responsibility to learn all we can about what we're meant to be doing and never stop learning in line with our work and our aspirations. But we should never pretend to know what we don't know and never assume or guess. We should let life teach us minute by minute. And being teachable, no matter what our situation in life, definitely takes humility, courage, and authenticity. And I found it to be rare. It's very important as a member of Parliament. I think one of the advantages I had when I went there is that I knew pretty much nothing of what I needed to know, which meant I needed to access the thinking of people who understood those relevant issues that I was in a position to be able to give input on. So that is really important. So being self-aware is extremely important so that we are not putting ourselves in competition with other people, but that we understand that tension is a good thing because tension helps us to keep each other in some sort of check, but we're not competing, we're completing each other. So the tension is important, but tension not to compete, but to complete each other. So which kind of leads me on then to this whole cancel culture thing in today's world, which I think would be worth touching on. You know,
but we always seem to have, just hold on, we'll mute the person. Okay, go on, ma'am.
Okay, so being tempted to embrace the attitude of cancelling people that we don't like or agree with is another thing that we must resist. We might think that this cancel culture is something new or something only woke people are guilty of, but it's not. Throughout history, ourselves included, people have had a tendency to want to cancel people that they don't agree with them. And it's not new, but it has been carried to such ludicrous lengths in today's world that it is so clearly absurd. This, however, may be a good thing. Not right or less problematic, but at least we cannot pretend to not notice how insane it is. So, like watching Republicans and Democrats canceling each other is like a Hollywood version of the games people play all over the world. And we see ourselves as the good guys and those who don't agree with us as the bad guys. And we want to silence or annihilate them. Really? In the name of democracy or humanity or even Christianity? So this is not just one section of society guilty of this cancel culture. We are all vulnerable to this cancel culture, and we have to not fall into that trap. So people are not all good, they're not all bad, and no matter how superior we might think we are, we're not. So we will all have our strengths and our weaknesses, and we must learn to hear each other and find ways to share this planet and our resources. So I've sadly observed that in politics, too many people are quite fearless about finger pointing and dishing out insults, but they're total crybabies when it comes to being on the receiving end. Suddenly we become so fragile and we insist on that our outrage is only to protect other adults from any form of robust debate and bad ideas. Yes, protect our children by all means and deal with criminal and corrupt behavior by upholding the rule of law. But canceling free speech and censoring all adult interaction, ideas, opinions, and debate does not make sense. So at least as women, we can choose now to rise above the pettiness that we see all around us and choose not to retaliate or behave as if we're so fragile that an inappropriate, unfounded, patronizing, or bigoted remark undoes us. I would like to see us responding graciously and kindly in stark contrast to other people's behavior, to prioritize unity for the sake of getting on with the job and avoiding passing on the aftermath of civil and border wars to our children. So that would be where my focus is. That we don't have to rely on what other people do or what other laws are put in place or anything. We just have to model the behavior that we want to see and do it knowing that as human beings that we're interacting with, and they're not going to be perfect and they're not going to be what we want. We must deal with people as who they are and not who we want them to be.
Thank you very much for that, Mrs. Dudley. And the chat room is on fire with a lot of questions, and it's interesting that we've only got two panelists this time around, and I think people are making use of that opportunity. We will try as much as we can to get through some of those questions, so which I am going to ask one of the questions, you know, which is in line with some of what we've been talking about in terms of solutions. And I can see a lot of people are talking about how religion, you know, and politics, we can't really kind of separate them and the role, you know, religion still plays. And especially like Dr. Lydia said, South Africa has over 75% Christians, and you know, religion and what they're doing should still count, you know, in terms of something. But let me go on now to the question here, which I believe is useful. And like since Gwen said, there's going to be a masterclass in November, an event organized by leading women of Africa. And, you know, this is going to focus specifically on women in politics. And it's good we're getting all these questions, and it's good we've got all the people here. So if you haven't registered yet, or if you want to find out more, go to the Leading Women of Africa, you know, website, and Mrs. Madeline will talk more about it. But this question is in terms of young people. So Ms. Meth said, and this is directed to any of you, but I'll probably start with Sis Gwen. To any of the panelists, do they think that our generation, and I believe it's the young generation, has it in them to lead? The honest truth is that we want to take up space in a more learned generation. What are the advices you can give us taking over as younger women in Africa? And what mistakes did you make, which we should not make? Which is a good point. I agree with that. And she's saying as well, politics is becoming very toxic, whereby people join, you know, for their own personal enrichment. How do we change? How do I, she's referring young people, change that as a young woman and fight for young women? Says Gwen.
A very good question indeed. And the response would be, I've taken my face away again.
We want to see your beautiful selfie. There we go.
No, I was saying that there is space for young women to take over. I know of a number of women who are still in parliament who would be very happy to relinquish their seats if they know that they are giving the seat to a person who is going to be driving what we have been driving. The difference between them and now and us is that we were sent by communities because communities had special certain needs. And if they want to make it a career, with us, it was like sent to go and do something for your party and in particular for your communities. And most of us were linked to rural women. So urban young girls don't actually feel that they fit in, because the kind of things that they go to study and ultimately want to be parliamentarians, they find that there is no link between those two. So I would advise that no matter how young she feels, and she feels that she would like to be a part of the political situation in South Africa or anywhere in Africa, take it. Take it upon yourself. Show your hand and say, let me be counted. I really want to participate. And that is why I am saying people like Cheryl and myself and Batavile and those of us who have served before in parliament should then be that think tank that these young women should be running to. That is why I am so happy about our November meeting, because that is where we're going to be surrendering ourselves to say, young girls, new MPs, we are here as a resource. Don't go through what we went through, excuse me. I've pleaded guilty already from the beginning.
So don't
go through what we went through. I mean, if you look at when women were allowed into parliament, that we did not even have restrooms for women. There would be a time that you stand at the door because your friend is using the bathroom and you have and you say to the men, no, please give us a chance until we manage to fight and get that right. So we have done a number of things right for them, just like the women of 1956. They gave us this freedom, and it is our responsibility to make sure that when we hand it over, it is no longer freedom, but it is expertise, it's wisdom, and it's also experience. Because through the years, we managed to get experience and we managed to get exposed. And that is what we want to give to the young ladies starting from November this year. We want them to be interested in politics because we want to make politics very attractive for them.
We'll let you have a break because I can see you're struggling with the flu. You did see already. But I want you to come back on the mistakes, because I think it's always useful to know what are the mistakes, you know, that what they can learn from. I think that's a valid question, and we'll want you to be, and I know you're a very honest person. So what are some of the mistakes that some of our young ones can learn from that they will not make? Let me allow Ms. Dudley, while I allow your voice to rest a little bit, Mrs. Dudley. So if you just come in, and then Mrs. Gwen, you come in on that.
Right. One of the big things is that we need to learn to shut up at times and not always have to have a comment, because we can learn a lot from what we want to immediately respond or react to. And that would be all of us. And that I can remember I'm laughing now because I'm laughing at myself. Is that the 30 years ago, that girl who went to parliament. So it doesn't depend on our clever, smart response. It depends on what are we hearing, what are we listening to, and where can we take this in a positive direction. So and it doesn't mean you're going to take it anywhere on that day in a positive direction. So it's having a teachable spirit is so, so very important. And then there's that defensiveness, you know, because we all got our complexes and our issues, and if somebody touches on that open wound, then comes back the attack. And that is just so counterproductive. And it is so amazing how people respond when you actually treat them with respect. So let's be diplomats, young ladies. And of course, young ladies, first of all, nobody needs to get into parliament before they actually are ready to get into parliament. You need to study to show yourself approved. You need to work and show that you're able to roll up your sleeves and do what needs to be done in any given situation. Because you're not a true leader of people if you're just there to tell everybody what to do and what you think and what your opinion is. You're a leader when you're the one who's actually shoulder to shoulder with uplifting people and making a difference in the situations that we want to make a difference in. And of course, learning everything we need to know about this area of work that we want to get into. So but going back to let's be diplomats despite the worst provocation, this is important. Let's learn to laugh at ourselves and to cut other people some slack. They'll eventually get it or not, but we do not have to allow ourselves to be dragged into destroying ourselves and others just because some people want to throw their toys out of the cot. Chaos is extremely dangerous. It is very important that we protect the rule of law and that we have an understanding of the value that there is in democracy and all its faults, because democracy is not the perfect be all and end all, but it is something that we choose, and if we choose it, we have to take care of it. So a happy life isn't always about doing what we like, and it doesn't always depend on us reaching our goal. And this is important. You may not reach your goal, but it's about the journey. And we can decide to make the journey and the people that we meet along the way, on their good days and their bad days, matter. So people matter. So the biggest thing, you cannot be a good leader if people do not matter, and because you'll just be abusive. So we need to build a culture of valuing good, honest work. And the way to do that is you start by do that good, honest work. Don't try and put yourself in a position that you're not ready for. Do the work. And working together to build and to rebuild. So we mustn't be afraid of building, and we mustn't be afraid of rebuilding. When somebody pulls something down, it's not the end of the world. We're going to rebuild it better, stronger, and together. So let's learn from the past and not get stuck in it. Let's forgive people who just haven't caught up yet. That would be my advice to young ladies. Our young people are fantastic. They have tremendous ability, way more than we have to give. So they're oozing with potential. And you're right. This is what our purpose is now, is to be here for those who need a stepping stone. We didn't have role models. We didn't have people, other women to look at to say they did it like this or like that. But I must say, I made everybody my role model, men and women. They didn't even know it. But I was watching and listening and learning. So you don't have to have somebody reacting to you for them to be your role model and your mentor. So you can collect mentors and learn from people along the way.
Right. Thank you very much for that contribution, Mrs. Dudley. And there's so much happening in the chat room. In fact, I don't know. it's been on fire. It's been, you know, there's so many questions. There are people answering the questions. There's more coming up. Please, you know, remember as well, if we don't ask your questions, please don't be offended. We are trying as much as possible to go through as much as we can, because like we said, this is interactive. Some of the questions that have been asked, I think there was one in particular by Comrade Jerry from ICT consultant in Nigeria, where he was asking about challenges women face in politics. I think we touched on that earlier, the solutions and so on. We're probably going to talk more about it. What initiatives or policies can be implemented to increase the participation of women in politics? It's something definitely was one question that I was going to be asking anyway, because that is key to all what we're talking about. So let me go back to Sis Gwen, and remember, keep asking there. If we cannot answer, we will try as much as we can to come back to you, or, you know, at a later event as well, or in November, to make sure that those questions are basically being answered, you know, in November. So I know Miss Madeline is collecting all of them, especially this one, because there's a lot being said in that chat room that, you know, we will not have time to cover fully. So Sis Gwen, if I could get you to start with, maybe starting with the mistakes and then briefly, and then, you know, what initiatives or policies can be implemented to increase the participation of women in political leadership roles, because that is mostly the problem, you know. And our question, my question was going to be, yeah, in all African countries, we know we have all those policies. How are we implementing them? Because implementation is really the issue. Okay.
Okay. I don't know why I always deprive you of my face.
video, ma'am. We want to see your beautiful face.
I want to respond to the question of mistakes. I get very sad when I hear a woman who's being interviewed not even understanding the subject matter. So my first thing is, if you are ready, don't get into it. If you are not ready, don't get into it. Allow yourself time to be ready so that nobody is going to take advantage of you. You must understand that people like Winnie Mandela, Adelaide Tambo, Lillian Ngoyi have always fought patriarchy. And patriarchy will always find its ugly head wherever there is an opportunity. Don't allow yourself, if some of your comrades would say, you know, we want you to take this position. Look at yourself, have faith in yourself and tell yourself, am I ready or not? And if you're not ready, don't take that position, because it's no point. I used to go to the UN and everywhere fight for women percentages should be risen. And what countries did? They did put those women into positions and frustrated them, left them there because they did not know what to do. I will send to Madeleine the latest IPU statistics on the percentages of African women in government. Since Joyce is here, she can also attest to the fact that they would come into parliament and sit there for months and months without participating. We don't want to see our sisters failing, but we want our sisters to say, I am ready. And if I am ready, I'm going to look for all the paraphernalia I need to make me a good speaker. And the minute people don't listen to you when you speak in parliament, you must know that your message is not relevant. You need to know that when you are elected, you need to spend a lot of time in the libraries. Nobody has to send you there, but you must go there and conduct your own research, unless you can afford a researcher. But if you cannot, you are going to be a researcher yourself. Study and get involved in leadership training programs, which are given by all institutions in South Africa. Go and enroll and make sure that you understand the subject matter, because for as long as you don't understand the subject matter, parliament is going to be frustrating for you, I must tell you. We had to work hard, burn the midnight oil, just to make sure that the next day when we meet with our counterparts from anywhere in the world, we can actually play that part. It's not easy, but it is doable. If I could do it, Cheryl could do it, and any other woman could do it, with no resources, by the way, with no role models. What she said there was very important. There was no Mama Kay who was a member of parliament before me to teach me that, you know, Gwen, this is how you have to conduct your speech. This is how you have to dress. Starting from small things like dress code, you need to know representing the nation. And when the nation looks at you, they must feel very proud of you. And your subject matter, study, make sure that you research. You go to people who have been there before you, who have studied the subjects before you. I mean, today I can write any speech on the environment, but when I was given that responsibility, I wanted to cry. I remember begging the chief whip that, can't I be in the education committee? He says, a decision has been taken. Comrade, a decision has been taken. You are going to environmental affairs. And you know that I have two options. I swim or I'm gone. And once you choose to swim, then you're going to make sure that, A, you knock at those professors. I mean, most of the professors in Cape Town knew me by name because I would be there, professor, I'm here. Can we discuss this matter? Because I used to have a strategy which worked for me. I used to say, if you fold your arms as academics and you don't want to give in and help, we are going to pass very inferior laws. And unfortunately, those laws are going to affect you and your children. So you choose to help and make sure that we implement the best legislation. And we managed. We managed. And like Cheryl says, don't get into things that you don't know. Make sure that you equip yourself with information. When you stand up and say Martin Luther said the following things, it should be because you read, you researched. Don't just go there and want to talk about things that are irrelevant because you think you don't like the speaker and then you must shoot her down by funny remarks and so on. Do it through facts. Do it through facts and say, Madam Speaker, you're not fair because of the following things and so on. And know the rules of Parliament. As soon as you are told that you are making it nice onto the list and there is a possibility that you may go to Parliament, equip yourself. And that is why I am so proud of LWA by coming back with this think tank, which is going to help women of Africa. Without that, the women are nowhere. Honestly speaking, we need to make sure that we assist them. And we are very proud that as we leave our seats, they can be taken by girls who can run and do the work and who are not going to be put there by their male counterparts to make them jokes. No, I don't agree to be made a joke. If you know that I know nothing about something, don't agree to do it. So my greatest response is that be ready. Know what you want to do. Be equipped for it. Then you're going to enjoy yourself there. Thank you.
Now, it says Gwen. Okay, maybe we'll give you a break because I wanted to, that's just powerful feedback, you know, there in terms of the mistake and what you need to do. I think my question as well, and we'll probably have one more question because I'm looking at the time now. And there's so much, you know, in the chat room, feedback, even solutions. I'm seeing solutions, you know, even in the chat room by some of the delegates. And this is what this is about. This is not about the panelists alone just telling us what they think solutions are. This is an interactive, you know, session, conversation. So please come up with solutions as well on some of what has been spoken about, or even share your own experience as well. And I can wait, see a lot of people already sharing the experience. And I can read Miss Meg saying she can't wait for November. We're learning. We are indeed learning. So the implementation of the policies, I don't want that to get lost because policies and, you know, we're good at writing policies in Africa, in politics, in, you know, every area of work, in corporate. However, the issue is always about implementation. And I think that question was asked by Comrade Jerry. And as well, that was a question as well that we were going to ask you as well in terms of, you know, yes, a lot of African countries have policies, good policies, by the way, on paper. But how do we make sure they're being implemented? And especially in terms of this underrepresentation, you know, of women in politics. And yes, some countries are doing more or better than the other. I don't want to start naming names in terms of African countries because this is not a competition, but it is about how we're learning. So those who need to do more, you know, we already have a country or a few countries actually in Africa where we've got female president, or I've had female president, Malawi, you know, and so on, and currently a few other countries. So yes, and some countries, we don't even have female governors, as you know, as we say, yet, you know, in Africa. So how do we make sure policies of, okay, yes, it's good, we want to have so numbers of women, you know, youth, or so number of women in politics or parliament, as it may be. How do we make sure that policies are implemented? And anybody else that might have the answer, please put it in there in the chat room as well, because we're learning, we're all learning. So can I start with you, Mrs. Dudley? So
we
have yes. Time to rest.
Am I on? Am I on? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, that's great. Gwen is one of my many heroes. We went and found out. So nothing should stop us. If there's a calling on our life to do a specific thing, and if it happens to be politics, we mustn't come up with excuses that this wasn't there or that wasn't there or this person or that person. We have what it takes to find out and to learn and to get the job done. So that's just my bottom line. That's so important. But I've also found that it's appropriate. It's important that opportunities to address topics are done when the opportunities come up. So in other words, what happens is if we don't take the appropriate opportunities, we're going to just blurt out whatever we're thinking anywhere and everywhere. And that we're just talking about mistakes. That would have been one of my mistakes, when you just want to blurt out whatever you're thinking or whatever. There's a specific time when you're talking about a specific subject, stick to that subject. When there's a purpose, stick to that purpose. So it's a case of reining yourself in, because so much can pull you all over the place. And then there's a platform. When it's your turn to speak, speak and give it all you've got. Don't start speaking when it's someone else's turn to speak. This is what it undermines us moving forward and getting on and implementing the we're forming the policies and then implementing them. So a lot of problem for me over the years would be the political games people play in Parliament actually stops the implementation of policy. So in other words, there's a majority, we have the democratic process, the majority of people, we go and we do as much to keep things open, transparent, democratic, have the interaction, the participation, and we try to make things as democratic as possible. And then we have a policy that the majority votes for. And everybody does their damnedest to undermine that policy, not because it's a bad policy or not because of any particular reason or because one little thing in it is not the way you wanted it. But so we have to get a broader perspective. Yes, when you're working towards putting that policy in place, bring the arguments, bring the discussion, bring everything you've got in terms of trying to impact it for the better. But once you've decided as a majority to go for something, get behind it and make it work. Nothing will be perfect. There isn't a perfect solution in an imperfect world that is inhabited by imperfect people. So, but if we decide collectively we're going to use this to get this job done, then for goodness sake, let's use it and get the best result we can. We can make it better next year or the year after or whatever, but let's get behind it. So it's the same with you put a certain government into position and then you spend the entire 5 years undermining everything that they do. That is just so counterproductive in terms of the country as a whole. So you wanted something different, but you didn't get it. So get behind this thing. Let's get the best out of it. They will not be perfect. They will be human beings, but they won't be all bad. So let's make the good part work the best that it can. And then let's try again to convince people for the next election that there may be a better way. But even our better way will have its problems and have its issues. So if we can, these may stand a chance. You realize when it's time actually get behind whatever the majority.
Wow, thank you very much. So this is Gwen.
If we can just agree that when a sister wins, we all win, and we promote sisterhood, you must succeed because you know very well that there's a pool of sisters who are surrounding you. What I did during my initial days, I don't live very far from Medunsa that time. And I went into the university and I spoke to a few ladies and I said, I would like to have a think tank around my work. I would like to have documents that I will send to you to for proofreading or improving and showing me, referring me to books and so on, because I wanted to succeed. So I'm just saying to everyone who really wants to make a difference, it is very important to succeed in everything that you're doing. Cheryllyn is right that you don't want just to be taking out hot air because you haven't researched, you haven't done anything. I will never allow myself to be a fool or stand in front of people when I do not know what I'm talking about. So it is very, very important that we equip the women, we make sure that that implementation that we speak about all the time, we pass the best legislation, but there is no implementation. And as a result, there is no service delivered because we are not doing what we're supposed to be doing. And it also comes back to say, at national, provincial, and local government, we need to be working together. Because remember what I said about our Cuban experience. The purpose should be to look at the national figure, the national big picture. What is it that we want to achieve for South Africa and not for women around my street only or around my village? So it is important for ladies to equip themselves with information and knowledge. And it does not mean that you have to be educated to undertake that. I usually say, when I find a person struggling in English to complete an interview, why don't you do it in your mother tongue?
Your language.
Why did we pass 11 languages? Now we even have 12. And people still struggle to want to make, because the reason why people voted for them was not because they speak the best English, but they make a difference in people's lives. And you can make that difference in Tswana, you can make it in Zulu, you can make it in Xhosa, you can make it in any language that is there. Now you can even make it in sign language where everybody will be able to follow you. So please, please don't limit yourself and use English as a litmus test that checks on your how intelligent you are. No, it might be a convenient language that is spoken by everybody, but it does not actually say this is how intelligent you are. You may be the most brilliant person, but putting it across in Tsonga for people to understand. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's going there. Wow. I'm looking at the time. We're 9 minutes past 6 o'clock South African time, which means 21 minutes time we will be finishing. Unfortunately, I have to stop there so that we can take all the other things on the program. However, I want to just quickly go through very, very quickly, because the chat room and technical admin support for both Leading Women of Africa and Boldness Africa, please, we need to make sure we get all this comment and questions, you know, somewhere, because there's such a lot of good points, solutions, and so on in there that I know we need to follow up. So please, we need to make sure we do that. And not forgetting that, yes, we are live on Facebook, and there are probably questions as well on there that we haven't really answered. This just shows you how there's so much to talk about, but there's so much in terms of action that we need to go away with and implement ourselves. So let me quickly, just very quickly, I'll pick, not in any particular order, some of the, you know, comments that have been shared in the chat room. Sipokaze is saying it is crucial for women to cease belittling and looking down upon one another and instead unite as a powerful collective and supporting to support each other. And then Sis Mukami, all the way from Scotland. I already mentioned Scotland earlier. I'm sorry, I'm being partial to Scotland now. She's saying greetings from an African woman in Scotland, who is from Kenya as well. The role of the media is very important in building or destroying credibility of women leaders. We need women-friendly journalists to report fairly and responsibly. She knows what she's talking about. She's got an MBE from the Queen of, late Queen of England. And then let's go on more. Last one I think I'm going to take from here. Sipokaze is saying a lot there. Let me see somebody else who I haven't read what they're saying. There was one for me about the male one, but because we're running out of time, the patriarchal situation, the makeup of South African politics, how do we change the patriarchal system, so on and so forth. There's just so much in there. Implementation is a problem. If you fold your hands as academics, we will pass laws that will affect our children. Thank you for that. Ntabiseng, thank you. Thank you. Swim or Sink, Abigail, thank you. There was one in particular. Okay, yes, Memuna, I wanted to read that one. Women need serious and sincere mentoring in politics because there are many of us that really want to contest but hate going through the negative sides of qualification as enshrined by the male folk. We need laws that will protect our integrity. Nobody should be given an alternative to participate in politics or any office elections. We must all be out to support ourselves. We must show them our capabilities and merits, not our endowment and beauty. We must show them that we are indeed a force to deal with. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you to our panelists. I'm going to hand over to Miss Madeline just to, you know, share with us and sum up what our panelists have said.
Wow, it's overwhelming. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for this. It's really an amazing session that I must say I've learned a lot. I've learned a lot from the panelists. And I've learned a lot from everyone who has contributing in the chat. This is definitely what we are looking for. I think there were quite a number of solutions. I know there are a lot of problems that were highlighted, and one of them being, you know, we need to earn respect. We need to really equip ourselves, you know, with as much skills as possible so that we can be able to basically honor the position that we are given. And I like what Sis Gwen says, that we don't want to be set for failure, because that definitely what is our undermining our basically our way, our responsibility or our opportunities to even increase the numbers. But what is important, I think from both speakers that I can highlight, is the call to unity. The call to unity, that we need to act collectively, like many of the participants in the chat have alluded to that. We need to work together. We really need to hold hands. I think we need to revive that sisterhood spirit that, like Sister Gwen, Mom Gwen said, if one sister wins, we all win. How are we gonna do that? Is when we start holding hands, when we start supporting one another. And thank you so much. This is definitely something that we would like to take it forward. And as Mrs. Mahlangu said, let me just share with you, a little bit about what she was alluding to in terms of the think tank that we are looking at from from this year. So in November, just one second there, we are just so excited to share that in November, we are starting, so under our School of Politics, or the faculty of, we do have Leading Women of Africa has a leadership institute, and under the Women in Public Office faculty, we are going to start Women in Politics Masterclass. So the program will be in November. So if you are aspiring politician, or you are already in politics, whether you want to learn more, you want to enter politics, or maybe you are a retired politician, and you would like to contribute to this, you will get in touch with Mama Gwen, who will be leading this department or this faculty. It will be led by Mom Gwen, who will lead us on that. And just to give you a little bit overview of what will be happening in November, it will be a full day of masterclass, and we will try to cover as many topics as possible. Obviously, one day is not going to be enough, but we'll try to cover as much as possible from women, women's political participation dynamics in Africa. We'll look at, again, in more details, the challenges, the strategies. We'll look at the personal branding, communication, which is really a must. We will look at turning men into strategic allies. You know, so it's quite important as we navigate into this world that we need allies, we need men as allies. How to winning women's support, like we are talking here, we need to hold each other's hand. And how do you plan your political career, from campaigning, communication, fundraising, you know, the skills for fundraising, the governance and integrity, which is very, very important topic that we need to look at as women. And in 2024, we will be looking at really great programs mentorship program that will be launched early 2024. And during the year, really, we'll be looking at the think tank meetings. We'll be looking at, you know, how we can give, how we can support the young politicians, you know, so they can really be the light. They can represent our interests there. There will be training and more masterclasses on a regular basis, and also retreats. You know, from time to time, we'll be coming together. We pick a city, we go there, we just spend time away from families, from any influence, so we can really, really brainstorm. And we will be coming out of those retreats really strengthened and equipped to face our next level. So that's basically what we'll be looking at in 2024, but starting from November, more details will be shared within the group where you registered as soon as possible, so you can start basically registering for November event or for November masterclass. And so you will get more details very soon. And you will also get information on membership, because this is a program that will run through membership. So if you are a politician and you would like to be part of that, you will be given the opportunity to be part of the membership, so you can benefit on every program, all the programs that we'll have throughout next year. So thank you so much again for your commitment, for your contribution. I'm sure we are living out of here with a different perspective on how we can support each other as women, on how we can move forward, how we can encourage more youngsters, young female to join politics. You know, we are all needed there so that we can make an impact. Our continent needs us. The future is female, indeed, the future of this continent is in our hands. We must never, never forget that. Thank you so, so much, Mama Kay.
Wow, thank you for that song. Oh, and the chat room is still hot. That's the only way I can say. It's still really, really hot. There's so much going on there. A lot of people are talking about the fact that they want mentors. They want to be part of the mentorship program. A lady who is a politician herself was asking about how do we, and that's something maybe you want to take to the November class, how do we get women who have disability as well into politics, because she is a politician herself, but she's somebody who is physically challenged. There's so much there, Rainey. Andrews, women have always been marginalized. I love the talk, it's educational and inspirational. Emma, yes, let's join hands, women, and transform Africa. Yes, don't leave anyone behind. Karibu, that's my sister, I believe, from Kenya. So we have Kenyans, we have a lot of people in the house. Uzo Amaka, thank you. You're glad to be here. Very educative, all the way from Abia State. Dr. Kalu, interested, please. My group members proclaim Nigeria Women Project Worldwide. Yes, we could do more collaboration with other groups. This is what this is about. You've heard earlier on about we should complement each other. This is not about us women competing. We should work in unity. Yes, Maimuna, I'm just mentioning your name so we don't forget. You would like to participate in the mentorship class. So please, note that down, admin for LWA, note that down. Yes, I think it's Miss Angelina that was talking about women with disability and, you know, how to make sure they're not discriminated in politics. Yes, we are live on, share that to everybody else. Don't go away, I know we're almost finishing. We've got 8 minutes to officially closing this bit of the virtual roundtable of Future is Female, but you have to stay behind for the B2B and the after party, where you'll be able to share more about your business. You'll be given that opportunity. Normally we get people to ask questions as well, but it's been so engaging and so insightful. So there's been no time to get anyone, you know, to, although I didn't see any hands raised. So, but I guess people were asking their questions in the chat room, which is why the platform has been on fire. It's been hot. Yes. So yeah, there's even still more coming. Sipokazi, how do I join mentorship? You will know more about it. You're already on the database, and I think somebody was asking, how do we get the video? It is already live on Facebook through the Leading Women of Africa, and it will be shared on the Facebook page as well for Boldness Africa. And as well, there'll be an edited version that will be on Impact Africa, which is a program by Boldness, at a later date. So because you're on the database, we will be sending you the links when the time is right. And you can watch it on demand. So whenever you want to watch it or you want to share it with others. We need more people to be coming for more programs, you know, like this. The next program, Miss Madeline, I don't think we've said that. When is it? I can't remember myself.
We will communicate the September date. And I think, yeah, in the group, you are in the database, everyone is in the database. The September date will be communicated.
Okay, so the September date and the topic as well will be said, you'll be communicated. So if you've joined through somebody else and somehow, please go and register so that you can be on the email database and you're kept informed about what is happening. And yeah. I don't know if Mrs. Dudley and Mrs. Gwen, just I know we've got about a minute for you to just say anything. You know, I know Miss Madeline has said thank you to both of you, but I just feel we now have a minute for you, but to just say any words of encouragement to anyone, you know, here in the chat room or on Facebook or that might be watching. So can we go for you first, Mrs. Dudley? You need to unmute yourself, ma'am. Sorry.
Okay. I'd just like to thank you for your leadership and Madeleine, and just for the incredible efforts that you make in this direction, and just amazing creating, seeing a need and creating a solution in terms of a platform for people to actually get what they need from this platform. So I think just to honor you and to thank you for what you're doing, and thank everybody for lending their ears and their time. We know it's such a precious commodity, and I personally hope that it was of some benefit, and I really just wish you all everything of the best.
Thank you very much, Ms. Dudley. Sis Gwen, we want your video as well as audio. We lost Sis Gwen. Sis Gwen, are you here? She's probably multitasking. Okay, while we're waiting for her, remember, it is still the Future is Female virtual roundtable for August month, and the topic we've been discussing, if you don't know yet, is women's political leadership in Africa, the challenges and solutions. And we focus more on the solutions. How can we work together as a team? How can we work with other countries? What is happening in Kenya in terms of politics? What is happening in Rwanda? What is happening, you know, how can we benefit from each other? Whether you're in Nigeria, whether you're in Ghana, how can we learn? This is what this is about. And you heard Sis Gwen earlier on talk about the fact that, yes, the older generation in South Africa, because she's been there, want to hand over to the younger ones. So how do we bring young people on board? Some African countries are already doing it. How do we make sure we get more young people on board, women especially, into our politics? Because that is where decisions are made. We cannot keep sitting on the fence, you know, saying, oh, yes, this politician, this local councillor, or whatever it is. You've heard it all, it's not easy. And yes, we all need to walk the path. And I think Sis Gwen said, swim or sink. We're at that stage now where some things might not be working. How can we make sure we get a voice out there? How can we sit at the table? Politics is a good way to get representation. You've heard about the think tank. I know we're mentioning it again. We want you to know and know and know that there is something that's going to be done. So is they're going to be, you know, planned for November. Tell your friends it's going to be an hybrid program so that way you're able to get your voice, not just about politics, but about other areas. But this one has been a baby for the leading women of Africa in terms of getting women in politics, because that's really, really where we want to be. Okay, I think Sis Gwen has probably left the room. Let me stop there with just 2 minutes to go. And okay, somebody's saying they can't access a link. I'm not too sure what that is, so but I'm sure we'll find out what that is. But don't go away. And we're just going to start very soon. Okay, somebody was asking now, Mr. Sadi Abubakar, is there a fee for mentorship program? You need to come and find out. We'll let you know. So just be on the database so that, yes, even if you're a male, you can pass on the information, you know, to your female counterpart, family, friends, colleagues. So you need to let us know your email. And if you haven't given us your email yet, yeah. Okay, let us know. Okay, that's the link, the video. Okay, something has been shared. I don't know why you can't access it. Privacy. Okay, we're looking into that. Let me see what else. Okay, it's been insightful. Thank you all. Just to say thank you all for spending your Friday evening, afternoon, whatever time it is, from where you're joining, the UK, US. We have people joining from US as well. Thank you. Thank you. Baie dankie, as we say in South Africa. Thank you. Thank you. Nkosi. Eshe pupo. Dalu. What else? How else do I say thank you now? Merci. Merci beaucoup.
Bye-bye.
No, we're not gone yet.
Asante sana.
Bye. Thank you.
We've not finished. Don't go yet, everyone.
Don't go yet. No dancing today.
Okay.
Doctor, tell me, no dancing today.
That's what I'm saying. We've now finished the official bit. The official bit is finished. It's 6:30 on the dot in South Africa. So we finished the official bit. So we're going to do a B2B first, where we just basically learn about each other's business for about 5-10 minutes or 15, I don't know. And then we'll do the dance and the game of the after party. So Dr. Oji, don't go yet. Don't go yet. I'm watching. I'm seeing the numbers that we have been watching. So even our panelists, Mrs. Dudley, you cannot go yet. Everybody, this is now less formal. So I'll hand over to Ms. Madeline to be, and then we'll go on to the after party.
Right. This is the most exciting part. Remember, politics and business work together. Right? Yes. So we need to get into business now. We are in the room. Some are politicians, some are businesswomen, some have been politicians, some have now joined us in business. So we try to create this platform so that we can introduce the business opportunities that we might have. So everyone, please don't leave the room yet because we are just starting. So I will start. Everyone, while I'll be presenting, I'll take my 1 minute. Then you, everyone, prepare your 1 minute presentation if you have a business. And I know Dr. Dudley has a book that you can promote if you have it, have a copy ready. You know, everyone you introduce, you have 1 minute or 30 seconds, however Mama K will share, you know, to introduce your business. This is now the B2B part. So I will start from Leading Women of Africa. What else do we do? What else do we do in terms of business? We start organizing the event. Okay, so we are basically the first point of contact when it comes to networking, you know, and trade and investment opportunities, consulting opportunities, research surveys, you know, educational program. Please, if you have a need, contact us. These are some of our services. And I'm offering you a special discount. If you register for the EPG conference, which is happening in November from 16th to 18th, you qualify if you register and pay before 31st of August. Whatever fee is there, you can pay 25% less. So there's a discount there. Please join us. And if you are buying or selling or anything, you know, you want to come to EPG or the conference that we are having, there will be exhibition, you know, share your product, your information. Then there is the Futures Female Diary that we are preparing for 2024. If you would like to contribute, you would like to be one of the authors, please send us the information. We will share the information in the group, in the registration platform. So if you are here, you've registered, you will receive this information after this. Then the masterclass I've already shared. So more information will come into the masterclass within the next week or two, because we're just still finalizing all the details. Then, we do have a marketplace that we have just finished setting it up. So for all the product services, you know, project, please go into our business platform. You will see a marketplace where you can upload for free, you know, your product and services. I'm going to share this into the into the communication. Then if you are not yet a member of Leading Women of Africa, I will also share the communication onto on email. And like we said, we do have a leadership institute. So if you are looking for solution for your staff, members, please, we do offer corporate training, and you can contact us. And this is a hot opportunity. Someone in the room is looking for CMOS products. They say from Tanzania or somewhere in Africa. So this is how it looks like. We just received the information. Please, if you have, you are into this industry, I think it is a medicinal plant. If you are into this industry, get in touch with us after the service. There is an opportunity for you to start exporting because there is a market that is looking for this product. CMOS product. I've never used it before, but that is the picture. Then if you are looking to sell or buy, please join our platform. What else? The September, yes, Mama K, I left it empty because we still have to discuss the dates. Thank you so much. That was me. I hope I didn't use much of your time. We can move to the next person. Mama K, you want
to talk? Okay, I think, yeah, Nyansha wants to talk. She needs to leave in 15 minutes. She wants to talk about Social Impact Fund for Women Economic Empowerment. So Nyansha, 1 minute, 2 minutes max, please.
Yeah.
Video, you can as well. Your time starts now.
Thank you very much for the offer. I've got a 6 o'clock meeting. I'm talking from Guernsey, Channel Islands, which is between UK and London and France. And I'm setting up a $1 billion fund for women entrepreneurs in sub-Saharan Africa. And it's all about social and economic empowerment. So it's the model of it is a private equity model in that we get into business together and we take equity in the business. But the main thing I'm interested in is the impact it's gonna have, because I think if you empower women, they will feed their children, they'll make sure that they've gone to school, they'll make sure that they have access to health facilities and employ people. Africa is producing something like 10 to 30 million graduates per year, and it's only creating 3 million jobs a year. There's a really huge gap in terms of employment. And so we see our comrades, since we've been talking politics, drowning on the north of Africa, trying to come to Europe. So that's what really has incensed me to do something, that we should get a fund in which we create jobs in Africa, local jobs for people, decent jobs. And so anyway, I'm looking for potential business people who are interested in working with us to fund them and they grow their business. And I'm also looking for potential investors, social impact investors, to help me raise this $1 billion. It's very ambitious, but you know, if it doesn't scare you, it's not worth doing.
Exactly. Thank you very much, Yansha. That is so good, and good luck with your meeting.
I hope
we've got your details.
Yes.
Okay.
There's not one which says everyone. I'll put one before I go, my email and my WhatsApp number.
We'll do that. So next person, who wants to go next? Quickly unmute. This is now for anyone, just quickly to unmute and we hotspot the person.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Lydia. Lydia.
Good evening, everybody.
Wait, Dr. Evelyn, 1 minute. Lydia has got the mic before you. So after Dr. Evelyn, okay, go Lydia.
Okay, thank you so much, the editor and a publisher. I'm currently working on a program to develop new writers, and we are looking for veteran writers, people who have gone through the struggle, people who have led in leadership before, and they have not written their stories. They have done so much for their countries, but they have not put it onto paper. So we are busy profiling such people, and we want them to leave a legacy that will be read through the years. So That is what I'm looking for now. The people who can say, I have a story to tell, and we will be publishing them. I'm running a publishing house here in South Africa. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Lisa.
Yeah.
Okay, share your contact in on the platform as well. Remember, this is business to business. Do share your contact. So, Dr. Evelyn Oji, you can go now. You need to unmute yourself. Sorry. We can't hear you. You need to unmute.
Okay. There you go. Good evening, Mama K. And everyone present. I'm so excited, honestly. I've been enjoying the whole thing. I'm interested in making young people to have employment in my country. There's so much unemployment situation here. So I would like to collaborate with that lady to see how we can move things here, especially encouraging home gardening, at least for food. At least someone can have daily meals from home gardening, smart agriculture around, because there's no land. But if we can improve, if we can teach people how to have home gardening around their premises, and then at least have daily source of food and healthy food, I think that will go a long way to ease the problem of hunger and unemployment.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Oji, for that. I quite agree. If you could mute yourself, share your details here. Miss Lydia, maybe she's left, but I'm sure Miss Yasha, who was talking about collaborating on young, to address youth unemployment, especially.
Yes.
Food security is a big issue across Africa, in South Africa, in Kenya, all over Africa. And like you said, yes, we need to go back to agriculture. So yes, thank you for that. Let's see, we have maybe two more, and then we're going to go into the after party. So, but feel free, if you haven't spoken, share your details in the chat room. Remember as well, the PowerPoint that Miss Madeline shared, and they offer the discount they're offering. There's a lot of opportunities, so feel free to ask more information, there. So let's see, is there anybody else too that wants to unmute themselves, whoever I see first? Just two more, and that's it. Remember, this is business to business, or organizations. If you have something you want to promote within your organizations, why not? If you're an NGO, social enterprise, feel free as well to, you never know. You heard about the $1 billion fund in terms of social impact that Ms. Yensha was talking about, all the way from Gansu. So yes, let's see. Who else wants to talk? Let's see. I'm trying to see. I think there's a lot in the chat room. So we only have time for one more, I think, now. Let's see.
Mama K, can I share something?
Okay, Sadia Abubakar, is that you?
Yes, ma. Can you hear me? Good evening, all. Oh.
Right, so Miss Rennie Andrews and Sadia Abubakar, could you mute? You will go after Rennie Andrews, because I think Rennie Andrews started talking first. Okay, go Rennie Andrews and your video too. Thank you, ma'am.
All right. Good evening, everyone. And thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you, ladies. This was so insightful. I think for the talk on the political front, I really do believe that we need to support our politicians. I am the Treasurer General for the Black Business Chamber. I'm also Deputy Chair for Business Western Cape. And I have my own business as well, where I do trade and investments as well. But my core business as well, I started out in the construction industry. As women, we are being marginalized, and I do believe that we as women should support each other, lift each other, build each other, and encourage one another to go to that next level. So I'm really very happy for your chat. I am so happy because even with the lady that shared previously, because now there's more opportunities for women that want investment. I definitely will be contacting you to see how we can collaborate and facilitate and see how we can help our women in Africa to not just to be compliant, but also to be able to have access to funds. Thank you very much. Back to you.
Thank you, Miss Andrews. Thank you. And lovely seeing your beautiful face as well. Happy Women's Month to all our South African peeps. When are we going to get you here to be a panelist as well, Miss Andrews? But anyway, Miss Madeline, me and you need to talk about that. Okay, let's hear it from, and it's good to see women in construction and a lot of other things. The areas are male dominated. So Miss Sadia Abubakar, you next, and I think iPhone. We will allow iPhone and that's it. Okay, Sadia, go for
good
it.
Good evening, all.
Good evening.
Thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. Indeed, it is a learning space. I have learned a lot. So thank you for this opportunity. I wanted to share some of my experience. It may be useful to this space. So far, I am a health system strengthening expert. I work in so many international non-governmental organizations where we intervene in most of the rural health facilities, improve the capacity of healthcare providers as well as our community members for them to access the basic or the necessary services at the facility level. So recently I quit my job and I started putting some effort in some of the communities which I know they lack some basic services that will improve in their lives. So far there is this community that I identified. It was in Kaduna State. So I tried to look at the community and the women around that area that have poor health services and they are not doing good in terms of financially. So I tried to employ one woman that is skillful in terms of formulating this liquid soap, making Vaseline. So far I was able to train like 15 people from that community. But because of lack of funds, there was no follow-up. So for that woman, I forgot her name actually. So if there is a room for collaboration, I can share the name of the community, the contact number of the beneficiaries, women, including adolescent girls that are not actually doing anything. So they were part of the beneficiaries. So if possible, we can do that and see how we can help those people at the rural or at the community level. So that is all I can say here. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Sadia. That is good. And all the best, you know, taking that courageous and bold step to quit your job and what you're doing, and you've done training. And I think, you know, in the chat room, I did read, you know, about guests saying, funding and funds is an issue as well to go into politics, and funds is always a problem. But you heard Yasha earlier on, so we never know. And this is what this is about, connecting and interconnecting with each other. And if there's anybody that wants to make a link with Sadia, please, please, please reach out to her. Share your details in the chat room if you haven't done so yet. And I know a lot of people have to go, but we will try and round up for those who are still wanting iPhone. Please be 1 minute. We're just going to give you 1 minute. I don't know who iPhone is. This is why we say, please name yourself, rename yourself. iPhone, I think you did have your hand up. Just 1 minute, just say your name and quickly what. Yeah, is that iPhone now?
Hello, good evening, madam.
All right, good
I
afternoon.
Think I should be. I don't know whether it is me. It was afternoon, sorry. I think it's me, Maimuna.
Okay.
sorry.
All right, go ahead.
I am Maimuna Mani Angora. Yeah, I am from Abuja, Nigeria. And I was a staff of the Mariam Babangida National Women Development Center. I was a training director. I retired last year. Presently, after my retirement, I started an NGO with my friends, like a group we call it Supportive Mothers. And that NGO basically works with orphanages and widows and youth, especially drug abusers. We try as much as we can to rehabilitate them. If we have the chance, we empower them with, after giving them skills, like what I've been doing in the center, we give them skills in either sewing, fashion and design, makeup, soap making, perfumery, bead making, and so many other skills. Even masonry, we do that, artisanship. So we basically assist these young people so that we don't have many trends outside the nation that can create problems. And I would very much appreciate it. In fact, when I had Sister Nyasha talking, I was very, very enlightened, very happy that we have such a good woman trying to assist people. So I'd very much appreciate it if we can collaborate in some ways with Supportive Mothers and some other groups that are into these laudable actions to help our youth, let them understand the problems we are facing presently in Nigeria, especially, and the world over. Because I think basically all the problems we are facing in Nigeria are world over. We are not specific about just Nigeria, but we can try as much as we can to touch each and every place. And I would very much appreciate to if I can be mentored into politics, because I love politics and I've been assisting politicians since I was a staff in the center. I've been a member of one of the political parties, indirectly otherwise, and I'd very much appreciate it if I'll get the mentorship that will make me bold enough to come out and contest a position in my country. Thank you very much, and God bless us all.
Thank you. God bless us all. Thank you, IGM and Muna. Madam Madeline, I hope you heard there.
Yes, I am here. Good evening, okay. Ma'am. Good evening,
everyone. Hold on a second, Madam Angelina. Just hold on 1 minute. Okay. I'll get you on there. That was our last one. But okay, we'll probably run over. For those who want to stay behind, we'll run slightly over. I know Mr. Ibrahim Adamu has got his hands up. And then we'll have Miss Angelina. And that is the final one, because we're running out of time. We've run out of time. So thank you for that, Ajia Mimuna, for that contribution. I'm wishing you well with your NGO. What you're doing is what we're talking about. Helping with skills development, helping the young people, collaborating. So I'm sure, you know, follow up with Ms. Yasha there on anything that you need to follow up on. Okay, Mr. Ibrahim, and then we'll finish with Ms. Angelina. But 1 minute, if not, I'm going to cut in.
Hello, good evening. Well, yeah. Are you getting me?
Yes, we can hear
you. I would like to commend the effort of all the participants for today. I really enjoyed the events. And what I want the political parties, they're supposed to allow women to participate fully, but by giving them free forms, nomination form, in order for them to have, access to political space in the world, not only in Africa. So that is my own suggestion. So I think everything is going on as it is. I believe in women. They are very, intelligent. They are also very, they mean what they said. And I can say this, unlike we, because I know a lot of challenges. We will say something today, tomorrow. They say they are going to do something like that. They will do it.
Yeah. Thank you, Ibrahim Adamu. Thank you, and I completely agree. Miss Madeline, I hope you're noting down. Some countries, they pay for nomination forms, and that is a barrier, for women into getting into politics. So how can we make sure they're given free, you know, they're able to get free nomination forms so that they can have access to political space. Thank you, our E4SHIV male, for being here all the time. I know you are here with us regularly, supporting us and contributing, and hopefully taking some of what we're talking about to the men, you know, that you work with, and the men in your family and community. Miss Angelina, final one. That's it. And then we're going to just do a 5 minutes, because I know it's been a long, 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 long day, long week for some of us. Miss Angelina, 2 minutes. Please unmute yourself.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone. Good evening once again. And I must confess that this program is awesome. I've learned a lot from here. And I am speaking on behalf of women with disability. I am the founder of Inclusive Skill Development Initiative, which we train women and girls with disability on different
skills
and advocate employment in any kind. So, yes, we want collaboration, and that we are organizing, and we are in the process of registering a network which will not just based in Nigeria but all over other country. So we need partners to collaborate with us to move this train so that we will, our voices will be heard. I will not be put down anymore, because we have what it takes to contribute to the society and also help ourselves to stop begging. That is our aim, please. Thank you so much, and God bless you, ma'am.
Okay, shoulders. All right, music, let's go. Music, come on. All right. I have to drink, we like to do that well. With a beat.
Stop with all that.
you've all done well. Come on, give yourselves a round of applause. It's been a long day. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Have an awesome, awesome day.
That was beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone.
Thank you for the after party.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Love you.
Bye. Thanks, Dr. Miss Lily. Thank you for staying till the end. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That is amazing.
Thank you.